Good morning, everyone. My name is Michael. It is my absolute pleasure to be here. Everyone can hear me okay? Hello to everyone out there as well. I would like to echo what Peter said this morning, acknowledging the traditional custodians of all of the lands and the waters where we work, where we walk, where we live, and importantly today, where we play, because it's on that land that we may want to develop some facilities. So it's really important to have a solid foundation of what it is that you want to achieve before you set out to actually go and build anything. And so that's why we thought it was best to start the session rather than what often happens is, right, where can we get some money so we can build something? Let's find out what the right something is first, and let's build the right something and make sure that something is going to achieve what it is that we want to achieve. When we go on these sorts of journeys, thank you, it's almost like we're going on a road trip or a holiday. The thing is that where you all are in your journey is not the beginning. So sometimes for those, have some of you been involved in your organisations for a long time? Who's been involved for more than 1 year? All of the hands go up. Who's been involved for more than 5 years? Most of the hands stayed up. More than 10 years? 15? 20? 25? 30? 35? 40? 45? 45! So how many is it? 45, I've got to give you the first chocolate of the day. Well done for being involved for so long. Give a round of applause, everyone. Can I ask a very simple question? Do we operate in the same world we did 45 years ago? No, so it's a little bit different. Okay, so through the journey that some of you have been on between 1 and 45 years, things have changed. In the old days, you can probably remember some of the handshake with the mayor type deals where that's all it took. And you don't need to muck around getting approval. Like, we're just not for profit. You know, we don't need approval. We don't need to do things right. Well, that might have been the case 50, 60 years ago, maybe even 45, but it ain't the case now. So through your journey, you've accumulated some luggage. Some might even call it baggage. And that's some old ways of thinking that put blinkers on or put barriers on us on our ability to change. So some of the things that we talk about this morning, particularly as we start to get into some of the technical aspects that you must follow, it might be time to take out some of that old baggage, the old information, to make room for new information. Sometimes, particularly with a topic like facility planning and facility development, it even takes a bit of a mindset shift. So rather than thinking we are here because we are entitled, nobody said rugby, did they? Do we have any rugby people online? Who can I pick on? Oh, we'll make it not rugby. Rugby league? No? All right, rugby league. So we can't have a rugby league club saying, it's stupid that we've got to go through all of these rules. You know, in the old days, we just used to be able to bung up a shed and she'd be right, mate. You can't do that anymore. And the most important reason that you can't do that anymore, who would like to have a guess? What's the most important reason why you can't just bung up any old thing anywhere? Money? Permits? No. Safety! Yes! Who said safety first? You want a chocolate? So it's all about safety, because if you go building something that isn't safe, then bad things can happen. So that's why having a really good, solid foundation of planning is so important. So there are very dangerous words. I call this roadblock thinking. We do it like that because that's how we've always done it. Things need to change. The world has changed around us, so it's really important that we follow, because if we don't follow and if we don't lead, then we're going to have to get dragged along kicking and screaming. These are the things that I'd like to cover this morning to give you an introduction to facility planning. Now, in the short amount of time that we've got, obviously we're not going to be able to get into all of the details. However, it should give you a solid foundation and some very, very practical steps for you to take to set yourself on a journey of making sure that what you're planning is the right something to build. So that starts with understanding, firstly, what are we as an organisation about? And it's very easy when you're thinking, what are we as an organisation about, to say, well, we are everything for everyone. Who are our target customers? And to say, everyone. But it's not everyone, is it? we all do have a more narrow focus. If everyone in the Moreton Bay region said, yes, all of a sudden I want to join your organisation, you'd be a mess. You couldn't accommodate that. So it's to start to figure out what is our purpose so that then we can make sure that we're doing the right thing for the people who are best connected to us for our purpose. Then the big picture planning. So this is about us. Then this is about more where we are, and then getting into the more detail about what it is that we want to build. So the big picture planning is trying to avoid building pimples on the bum of society. Things that might, we think they might be okay, but then they don't fit in longer term. So it's understanding what fitting in actually means with our environment, with everything else in the parks that we occupy. And finally, how can we make sure that this is going to work? Again, this is about you. So we're starting and finishing with all about you. Do we as an organisation have the sustainability and the organisational viability and the financial viability to be able to make sure that we can continue to operate what it is that we're going to develop? Is that okay so far? Okay, but then let's get in to you. This is a really, it seems a really easy question to ask, but it's a very difficult question to answer. If I was to run around the room and say, tell me what it is that you do, you'd all be able to rattle it off, wouldn't you? Just think about what it is that you do. 10 words or less, make up a sentence in your mind. Write it down if you like. Anyone want to have a go? Go for it. To supply nutritional meals to local community. 7 words. Well done. I'm going to give you chocolate for that. Well done. Well done. This will go with your tea. Beautiful. We supply nutritional meals to the... Anyone else want to have a... There's chocolate. Come on. It's easy. All right. We care for carers. Oh, so you're starting to go beyond now, aren't you? Worth a chocolate. Sorry to all of those people online. I'm walking right down the back of the room to provide chocolate.
Community together.
Just because I'm standing right in, we pull community together. Yes. Now, what just happened is we moved from what to why. We're starting to use more purpose-driven statements now. The what statements are really easy. So we've still got no one from rugby league. I can keep picking on them. Rugby league, what we do is we provide a vehicle, we provide facilities, we provide a competition for kids of all ages to play rugby league. That's pretty easy. But when we get into the heart of it, why we do it is a bit more difficult to understand. Sorry, it's easy to understand because it's not what we do, it's what keeps us connected. So for that rugby league club, what is it that they do differently that makes people go to them, rather than going to other rugby league clubs or other sports or other pastimes, other recreational pursuits? That is then when we're starting to talk about purpose. So when you think about your purpose, some of it is in your constitution. Why you exist is the object, number 2 or 3 in your constitution. Pretty straightforward. But when you get down to it on more of a philosophical level, what I want you to think about is, why is it that we joined in the first place? And why do we keep coming back? Because if you understand what made you join that organization in the first place, that gives you some insight into what might make other people like you join that organization as well. What is it that keeps you coming back? These are the things that your organization does emotionally and practically. But by emotionally, I mean, what is it? What does it feel like when you're with people like you that you like? And how is it that this organisation creates a community? Because it's more than what we do. It's more than providing meals for the community. The people that are there because of what they get out of it. And it's your organisation that gives them that feeling of what they get out of it. Because when we say, why do you volunteer? Anyone want to have a guess at what the most common reasons why people say they volunteer is? Something to give back. Who said to give back? Yeah, chocolate. Well done. Absolutely, they say to give back. And it's not that it's the wrong answer, it's just that it's an easy answer. The right answer is actually far more emotional than that. But it feels like to give back, that's because this organisation or this community has given to me for a long time. Now it feels like it's time to give back. But what's actually going on is when this person volunteers for the excuse of giving back, there's a feeling that they get, a sense of belonging. Yeah, but how... chocolate. Sorry, I've started something, haven't I? A sense of, yeah, these are easy to say words, but everyone actually volunteers for the same reason, the exact same reason, because they want to volunteer. What makes them want to volunteer is completely different and completely different for every person. But it's not about the words that we put around it, the logic. It's more about the feeling that we get. It's how it feels in here. So what I get out of volunteering is a warm and fuzzy feeling that makes me feel like I am contributing. And it's not about the giving back. It's about to take the example out here, when I see the kids come off the court after a game of netball, basketball, futsal, I see the look on their face of sheer joy and exhilaration and excitement. And I helped that. And that's why I volunteer. For others, it's I see the look on the faces of the people that I deliver meals to. I've changed their life. I'm giving back. Boring when you think about the I'm getting goosebumps, that feeling of emotion. So that's where I want you to start. Before you think about anything that you're going to build, be really clear on that. What are those things, those feelings that make people connected to you, the warm and fuzzy that make people feel that they're connected to you? This is one of the things that I'm going to share with you through Linton after the session, is a one-pager that tells you how you can really easily do some high-level organizational planning. So let's start with number one. Start understanding why your organization exists. Yes, it's going to be consistent with your constitution, but when you do that, those are the questions to ask yourself first, because when you understand, firstly, why did I join this organization? And secondly, why do I keep coming back? Because that's when you're going to be able to find there's something in there that was good for you. And then you can start to put words around that that make that the sort of thing that you can explain to other people. Why would I join your organization? Why? Because all of your marketing can then fall around, be built around this. From there, you start to think about, well, what are the things that we want to achieve? Not what we're going to do, because we know what we're going to do, broadly speaking, delivering our core business. But what are the things that we want to achieve? What are our goals, our organizational goals? Note here, I've said it's okay to dream big. It's okay to have goals that are aspirational. Yes, there needs to be an element of we can do this. But when you set goals that are, just speaking specifically about building something, rather than saying, well, what can we build for, there's a grant available for $100,000. What can we build for $100,000? That's kind of the wrong way to think about it. When you start with a goal that is something that you need to achieve, if we need a facility to deliver something, what we do, and it's going to cost $1 million to do that, then that's how we should dream. If there is a way to start at 100 and work up to $1 million by expansion and extension, fine. But where was some bowls clubs? There was at least one bowls club. I've seen some bowls clubs, not locally, that literally look like you can see the first bit, and then you can see the next bit that was done when money allowed, and the next bit that was done when money allowed. And you miss the forest for the trees. The thing looks now unappealing, uninviting. It looks like the sort of place that I don't want to go and have a roll up or a beer, because it's being built to a budget rather than being built with what do we actually need to achieve here. Then you follow the process around SWOT, good old SWOT analysis. What do we do well? What do we not do well? What are our opportunities? What are our threats? And then we develop actions around those. So notice that the order here is quite, I'm teaching you nothing so far. You've seen all of this before. Maybe the order's a bit different though, because there's no point doing a SWOT analysis. And when you do a SWOT analysis, which of the SWO or T is usually the longest list? Weaknesses. Why is that? We're all too humble. Oh, we don't have that many strengths, but by golly, have we got a lot. And we write it on butcher's paper and we stick it up on the wall, and we've got all of this, pardon the French, all of this list of things that we're crap at, and we leave it sitting there on the wall looking at us, and then we go and say, right, so back to the Taj Mahal. Hang on, if we've got a weakness that says we are trading insolvent, maybe we should address that first. So that's why our actions then come out of that. So start with dealing with this stuff, because if there are showstoppers in there, you won't be able to achieve what you want to achieve. So make sure, that's why this is in that sequential order. And then adding timeframes and responsibilities. Then says that, so there's some other stuff on there about then using what you come up with here to come up with your vision statement, your mission statement, your value statements, and putting it all together. I don't actually mind how complex your plan is. I don't care how good looking it is. I've seen what we call in the industry thick and dusty plans that are absolutely useless, wonderfully written, beautiful stuff in them. But because they're thick, they sit on a shelf and get dusty. So somebody, you know, oh, look, it's 2022 and our plan was 2018 to 22. It's time to do a new plan. And they open it up and they say, oh, this is all good stuff. Maybe we should just do this. That was the idea 4 years ago. So if you literally have a plan that is scribbled on the back of an envelope, on the back of a napkin at Cafe 63 or the coffee club, that you'll do, that's a better plan because it's actually telling you what you want to do. It's important that you start here, though, because if you start with just wanting to build something, the question is that the right something to build? You've got to make sure that whatever it is that you're planning to build always links back to your purpose. Now, there's one more question that I'm going to throw in the mix. What sort of organization are you? You're all interpreting. I just paused because I wanted you to all interpret that the way that you interpret it. So for some of you involved in sport, it might be we are a pathway organization. We are, you know, the sport, the pyramid with lots of participation, the juniors down the bottom up to elite. Where in the pyramid do we sit? Are we a feeder? Are we a foundational organization, or are we at the pinnacle? Are we a high performance type organization? And can you be in multiple places? Right. So for those online, the comment was we've gone from big to small. And so it can vary what type of organization we are. But I'm very happy that you interpreted the question the way that connected with you. Because and even if that's all you do on the back of your napkin, that's really powerful because it makes sure that you understand. There's a great proverb, I think it's Chinese, lying in the same bed, dreaming different dreams. Does everyone on your committee have the same vision for the future? Does everyone on your committee believe that we are in the same sort of organization? Are we community driven? Are we finance driven? Are we out to make a buck? Recognizing that we're all not for profit, so at some stage that's all going to go back in doing better service for our community, our members. But be clear on what sort of organization you are and be clear together. That's why we start here. Because if you then go and build something, it might very well turn out to be the wrong something. Only yesterday morning, I heard about a club that has recently built a new building to $150,000. That's not what they needed. And yes, spending that $150,000 has put them into the red to the point of their solvency is questionable, which means that that management committee can potentially lose everything, lose their personal assets now, because the different people on the committee thought different things. This was a presidential dream and the president drove it. That president's now gone and the new committee has that as their legacy. $150,000 building that still doesn't meet their needs and a debt that they can't pay off. There's a different way to approach that. And again, this mindset shift, this changing gear and the way that we think about this stuff may say, well, instead of just going and chasing the grant and getting $150,000 and building something that isn't going to meet our needs, why don't we play the right game? It might take us an extra year, an extra 3 years, but if we've got the picture right, we can still sell that to our members and get them to buy into the picture of our goals, of what it is that what it is that this journey actually needs to look like. Does that make sense? All right. So that's planning about you. Now it's time to start planning about where you are. And this is the big picture planning. Of all of the councils that we at CPR Group get to work with, I'm not saying this because they're in the room, Moreton Bay does the best at organisational plan, at Peter put his thumb up, at facility planning, at master planning. Now that's because in Moreton Bay, council plans for things that they are going to build. I won't tell you which council, but I did a master plan in 2004. A council, and when they saw the price, this is all critical infrastructure. When they saw the price tag, they went, oh, and I'm going, but all of that stuff that's going to cost you, it's $16 million in the grand scheme of a council budget. Okay, it's a lot of money, but over time, if you take a reasonable approach to implementation, then that's exactly what you thought. You're going, oh, I didn't know it was going to be that much. What were you thinking? It's 2022 and that park looks exactly the same, just 18 years crappier because everything's aged more. And the organisations that are there haven't had the council kick in the bum to say, let's make sure that we're making these places look good. Let's make sure that these places are functioning how you hoped that they would function. When we get down to the nitty gritty, this is what the end result may look like. Now, obviously, it's not technical master plan like that one, but this is how it works. Now, you can take these kids off a soccer field and put them onto a basketball court. You can take them off a soccer field and put them into a kitchen. You can take them off the soccer field and put them into a main arena at the showgrounds. It's about the activation of space. So a master plan is actually really easy to do. If you do a jigsaw puzzle, you know the bits and pieces that literally fit into the right places. But if you do a master plan like that, the site won't function to meet the needs of the humans that need to benefit from that site. So that's where proper master planning works. So when this club wanted to start, so this is the end result, but when they wanted to start, all they had was, what does it take to play football? Well, apart from about 11 people on each side and something to kick, we need somewhere to kick it. It has always made me chuckle, sometimes politely to myself and sometimes with a bit of a shin kick and a slap in the face, when people say to me, oh, Michael, if we don't have lights, we won't be able to play football next year. Going, oh, crap. Does that mean that the sun's not going to shine next year? There're going to be no days. They go, you know what I mean. Well, hang on. You said we can't play. If we don't have lights, we can't play at night. But it doesn't mean you can't play. So there's a big distinction between wants and needs. This is all you need to play football, is something to kick and somewhere to kick it. But this level of sophistication goes up, sometimes because we can see that we can give more to our members, but sometimes it's because our members say, hey, we want more, give us more. Either way, if you take a planned approach and you make sure that you're within the larger picture planned approach that council typically drives, then you'll make sure that you're building the right thing in the right place. If anyone else has their phone on, that's absolutely fine. It's just really embarrassing. That's perfectly okay. Okay, so when they said, well, hang on, now we want to make sure that we've got some ability to grow, then they put in a second field and bunged up some lights. North should still be north-south. Very good pickup. Now, the reason that this one went that way is because there's a tree there. And so they did their good planning and they did some arborist inspection and they worked out that the roots came that way. So they still wanted the playing space. And if that one's going to be used typically for training, typically under lights at nighttime, then the orientation was less important. But chocolate worthy pickup. Well done. Very polite. Then that's not all that we need. If we want to increase the intensity of usage of our fields, then we're going to need better drainage and we're going to need to be able to irrigate them. To make the playing and the spectating environment more comfortable, we're going to put in some seating. They're saying, oh, it's time to grow again. Our constituents are asking for more. They're saying, hey, we need some better car parking. We need some fencing. We need a clubhouse. We need change rooms. We need restrooms. We need toilets. If you see it develop like this, just with a few clicks of the slide, then you can see, oh, that looked really easy. But if they'd taken the wrong approach and they'd put the first thing in the wrong place, it may have stopped them being able to look and complete the whole picture. So that's why taking the right journey is much better than taking a quick journey. So start with yourself. Make sure that you're very clear on your purpose and then look at the big picture. How is what we're planning to build or develop going to fit in with the bigger picture? And you exist in a really fortunate part of the world where all of the people at council are here to help make sure that you're doing the right thing, thinking about doing the right thing in the right place to begin with. In planning, in negotiation, you're always thinking, what's the best path to get where we want to go? I'd like to take you in a different direction and say, how quickly can we get to the no's? Where do these showstoppers lurk? Just beneath the surface. Because if you don't find a showstopper until 9 o'clock the day after the grant application went in, then all of that work that you've done up to that point has been for nothing. So look for the showstoppers as early as you can. Don't be afraid of the showstoppers. Showstoppers are there, they exist. And what might they be? They might be things about planning. They might be, well, we can't actually build that in this area because of the planning, the zoning in this area. That's okay. If you know that, if you don't know that, you go planning it, you spend a whole lot of your volunteer time and some organizational money to get to a point, and then somebody says, hang on a minute, you can't do that because it's special purposes instead of open space or recreation or sport. So make sure that you're looking at all of these things. Is it going to be safe enough? Is there access? This is obviously an important one to think about right now. By the way, where do we build sports fields and community infrastructure? Dumps and floodplains. Is that okay? Is it a good thing or is it a bad thing? It's fine until it rains. It just rains and now it's not fine. But if we know that that's the case and we learn and look at the some of the different infrastructure that's been built now. I'm planning one with Brisbane City Council at the moment, which is both floodplain and dump. And the design of the building takes all of that into consideration. So while it's still going to be accessible, the thing's going to sit that far off the ground so that not if, but when it floods again, the water will go underneath, the services are up here, things are protected. So that's it. All of these things you need to know, because then maybe building down here, digging into the ground to put lights up on a landfill site that wasn't properly remediated is going to give you a no. Bless you. You're far better off finding those no's early than going through the process and what it ends up being a complete waste of your time to get too far down the track. Okay, on that, I would like to introduce the ABC Tiddlywinks Club Incorporated. Does anyone still play Tiddlywinks? You used to play Tiddlywinks, I can tell by the smile on your face. Tiddlywinks is a little game where you flick these little round things and you try and get them in a cup, as far as I know. But a fictitious club that we thought isn't going to step on any toes in Moreton Bay is the Tiddlywinks Club that exists in Moreton Bay. So let us tell you about the story of ABC Tiddlywinks Club, because then what I'd like to do is actually walk you through the facility planning process for something that this club is actually planning to do. All part of the story. They don't actually exist. Okay. Firstly, they lease a small hall from Moreton Bay Regional Council in Kalanga. They have 150 members, so that is a considerable membership base. And those members come from all over the region. They're the only Tiddlywinks Club in Moreton Bay. Given the fact that nobody remembers what Tiddlywinks is, they may be the only Tiddlywinks Club in the universe. They have daytime competitions 3 days a week. So obviously for the Tiddlywinks players, this is important. This is serious. Sheep Station Tiddlywinks. The committee meets at least once a week and they meet in the hall and they meet at night time. They then have regular facility hirers who hire the facility for a fee from the club, all of which is okay under the lease agreement with council, in the evenings when they're not there. So that's a pretty good looking club. Let's talk about the building now. It's your typical Moreton Bay Hall. It's probably could have been built 15 years ago. It could have been built 150 years ago. It's probably the same sort of hall. Timber building, concrete slab, about 15 years old. As you walk into the building, it's a big expanse, big, nice big open hall. Then you go down the back of the hall and that's where the kitchen and the dunnies are. The dunnies are one male, one female and one accessible toilet. So it's not a lot, but there's toilets in the hall at least. There's no external storage in this hall, so it's just the hall that they hire, that they lease. That means that all of their storage needs and all of their administration needs have to be met in the hall as well. So they've got big cupboards lining the walls, and in there they store their Tiddlywinks, they store their tables, they store their computers, they store their admin files and everything, all in there. Does that sound familiar to anyone? So while we're talking about a Tiddlywinks club and nobody plays Tiddlywinks, we might as well be talking about any number of different organisations that do really exist in Moreton Bay. So now let's think about what sort of projects the Tiddlywinks club may be planning. Firstly, They'd like to upgrade the toilets. They'd like some external storage. So they realize that by having all of the storage inside, it's taking up valuable, usable area. So they'd like to say, well, let's get that out. So let's build a shed. We'd like a general freshen up. The place is looking a bit old, not quite as bad as the bowls club. That's all like bits and higgledy-piggledy, but it's looking its age. And it hasn't, maybe it hasn't necessarily had the level of upkeep that it needs. So we'd like to give it a good freshen up. Then we'd also like to put our office space in the shed. So rather than just build a shed for storage, they've thought, well, hang on a minute. If we have our meetings in the shed as well, then that means that the night that we meet here, we're not meeting in the hall, which leaves the hall free for us to hire out. If we move all of our files and our tiddlywinks out of the hall into the shed, it means all of those cupboards in the hall can come out, which means that we've got more floor area in the hall, which then perhaps could increase the types of activities for which we could hire this hall out. Again, do some of these look like familiar projects? Anyone want to do something on that list? Dunnies, painting, building, changing the way I vote? All of them. Listen up. Okay. Now what I'd like to do is share with you 11 questions. Now these 11 questions are in a workbook that you will get, and it's nice and neatly laid out with this space for you to write the answers here. We are starting with the plan. We are not starting with a grant application. That is critical. We are starting with the plan, not with a grant application. So even if Sharon's able to give you information about a grant that will perfectly align with what you're doing, I want you to have the discipline to say, there'll be a time for that. Let's get the plan right first. The reason I'm making a bit of a thing about that is that all too often we plan for the grant, not what we need. These 11 questions are designed to unearth what you need, why you need it, and how you are going to be able to back it all up. Some of them may make you uncomfortable, and I hope that they do. So let's start by going through. We're going to take the shed project, so we can run the same process through all we can run all of these through the same process, through the same question process, all of which are in here. And by the way, don't do this as one person. This is a brainstorm exercise. Not who's the grants officer here? One, two, yep. Just because you're a grants officer doesn't mean you're the only one that does this. This is about planning collaboratively. The more people that are involved in the grants process from early on, the better. So this even takes you one step back. These are brainstorming questions for everyone to work on together. Question number one. Why do we need this shed? Let's workshop it. Let's do the brainstorm together. Why does the Tiddlywinks Club need the shed? Anyone? Storage? Yes. That's what they're going to do with it. More members? So, yep. What else? Activities, display, somebody said security. Security of files? Yep. Yep. What about the meeting? The fact that they're planning on meeting there? What would that do? Frees up the hireable space in the hall. Yeah, exactly. So we're moving our activities that don't make us any money. They're critical for the management of our association, but they're not making us any money. So they give us the ability to do that as well. Okay. How will the project actually meet those needs then? More income? Yep. Okay. What else? Builds a space that we need. Yep. Okay. So notice that these two are linked together. Why do we need it and how will it actually meet the needs? So let's think about how we need it and how we know that we need it as well. So do we have people that we're turning away? So that's the difference between want and need. Because if it's want, then we want to increase income. We want to increase the number of hireable nights. We want to increase the size of activities that we can hire this space out for. But if we need it, then we've already got people who are banging down our door to say, hey, we want to hire your facility, please. So that's how you can determine the difference between wanting it and needing it. What professional advice do you need? So remember, we're building a shed. What sort of professional advice are we going to have to take before we get in and do this? So all of those things with the guy there with the megaphone. Yes. All of those questions to get to know. Who can we go to ask those questions? Who are the people that we can take that advice from? Exactly. Yep. Yes. Yes. These people. Absolutely. If we're building something, then obviously we also need designs and costings. So the designers, the architects, the draftees, the shed building companies, whoever it is, but also we've got the building assessors. So if there's building approvals that we need, then obviously we need to involve those people as well. So all of that, all of the planning implications, these two are champing at the bit to answer these, which is perfect because they're the two. Will it make money or cost money? Once we build it, is this actually going to make us money or cost us money? What do you reckon? Cost money first. Why? Capital investment to actually build it. Yes. And then if we can increase the level of hiring, it'll make us money. What other questions does that then put into our mind? How much is it going to cost? How much extra is it going to make? How sure are we that we're going to make that extra money? And how long is it going to take before we've made enough to make it worth spending the capital in the first place? So another question is, if we aren't able to get a grant for this, would we still do it? If we had to go to the bank and take out a commercial loan to do this, would we still do it? That's one of those questions that's designed to make you feel uncomfortable. Probably no for guides. So guides can't take out loans. Yep. What about having enough money to do it? So then flip it around and say, well, if we can't take out a loan, would we wait until we can save up the X many thousands of dollars it's going to cost to do and then do it? You'd have to. Okay, so the reason that I'm pushing this point a little bit is called skin in the game. It's not these guys, but I sit in meetings with councils very often where, you know, because people like to have a bitch every now and again, I say, why do these people keep coming to me and saying, can you build us this $1 million facility? And I say, how much are you putting in? They say, oh, nothing. We've got nothing to put in. And then on behalf of council, I have to say, well, hang on. If you don't care about it enough to invest your own money, why should we? Why should the rest of the ratepayers who, for the rugby league club, might hate rugby league. For the Tiddlywinks club, might hate Tiddlywinks. Why should they have to put up $1 million when you don't want to put skin in the game? Would you do this if you didn't get a grant? Which means, will you be able to maintain it? Will you be able to repair it? And at the end of its life, will you be able to replace it? How long do you reckon the shed's going to last? How long should we give it in our planning? 40 years? 50 years? Okay, in 50 years, how much is it going to cost us to replace it? Let's say we're talking about a $50,000 shed in 2022 money. What's that going to be worth in 20, how many years did we say, 50? 2072 money.
$1 million!
Will we have $1 million to replace it in 50 years? Can we? What sort of process will we have to be able to do the scheduled maintenance, to be able to repair the roof if in 25 years, the screws have started to go a bit, how you going, and it lifts up and lets rain in. Okay, so for the people online, the question was, you've got to think, say we've got 150 members now, but what if we've only got 50 members in? Yeah, so we can do little steps. Okay, all right, let's get there. Sorry, next one. All right. We're starting to now get into that detail. What sort of research can we do? Now, the research that you can do, obviously, it's things like all of the list of things on the shouty slide with the planning overlays and the safety and all of the building codes. What do we have? What, that's the sort of research we can do there. We can also do the research of taking the professional advice. But what about council's strategy? So if we're talking about a community facility, what about council's community facility strategy? Is this identified in there? When we're talking about need, use your networks. So lean on your networks as much as you can. There are people who know how many people are getting turned away. So there are a lot of facilities that Moreton Bay Regional Council manages. So how many of those facilities are at capacity? How many of those? So we're looking not only at our ability to go and attract people that we know about, But what about the people who are getting turned away from other facilities as well? And what do they need? So will removing the storage from our hall and creating a bigger space meet their needs? So by the time you're doing, by the time you get through doing this research, you've got a much more confident picture of the business viability of what's going on. And I use that word unashamedly. Yes, we're not for profit, but it's always business. We do things, we provide a service. Sometimes there are some widgets that we sell, socks, boots, shorts, shirts, hats, but there's a fee for that. So people pay us for it, and that the people that pay us may be our direct recipients of members. So the Tiddlywinks players, the hirers of the facility, but it could also be government. If we are a funded entity, then it's the government funding that we're getting that is paying us to deliver a service. So it's always business, no matter how you look at it. So that's really important that you understand from that research, how viable is this going to be? Can we make sure that we're going to make it work? So that's getting into operations. This is the next and probably most controversial question. What alternatives exist? What else could the Tiddlywinks Club do instead of building a shed? Do they have to build a shed? Do they have to build a shed? Bring in a demountable? Well, they don't have to do anything. Maintain the status quo is an alternative, isn't it? Just limit our options, our operations to what we're already doing. Are we viable like this? Is that a viable alternative? What about, now the best brainstorming sessions are the ones where you throw everything on the table. What about if we don't have a lease at all? What about if we become a hirer of one of this or another facility and let somebody else lease it? Let somebody else paint it. Let somebody else replace the dunny paper and clean the toilets. It's an option. All of these, you've got to be very open when you're thinking about your options, because that passion that you feel that got you connected and keeps you staying there can also put blinkers on and make you think that we have to do this. And there are plenty of examples of organizations that have tried to bite off more than they can chew. A swimming club with 50 members who don't like Belgravia, the way that Belgravia is managing the aquatic center. So they say, you know what? We're going to go and build our own pool. You're going to go and build your own 50 meter indoor heated pool with an air conditioned gym for 50 members, instead of just building a bridge and saying to the management, oh, so we have to pay $4.80 now. $4.80 is a lot cheaper than how many millions is that going to cost? 100, cheaper than 100 million. What support can you demonstrate? Now, good support are things like letters of support, aren't they? But not a letter of support from the mayor saying, I think the Tiddlywinks Club is a wonderful organization and they have my full support. Is the mayor going to come and use it? What about letters from all of your groups who say, hey, we would really love to bring all of these other events that we can't have to your hall, but you got to get rid of the shelves. Hey, we are an organization that can't use your hall and we're finding it difficult to find somewhere else in the Moreton Bay region and we would love to hire your hall, but you're going to have to get rid of the shelves. Wouldn't that be more valuable? That sort of level of support. What about support from the planning team at council? Because the more of that that you're doing at this stage, we're not even at grant stage yet, the better off you are. What resources do you already have internally to be able to deliver this? Who are we going to need? We're going to need a project manager. We're going to need somebody who's good with money. We're going to need our grants people. What if we've even got some builders in the club who could do it? All of that is fine. But remember about the changing the way that you think. Just because we have a project management professional who is on the management committee of the Tiddlywinks Club does not mean that that project management professional wants to give more time and manage this project. So don't ever assume that just because you've got professionals with skills that they care enough to be able to take more time off work and give more to the organisation. Don't just assume. Don't just assume that because somebody on their form, on their membership form where you asked, what's mum and dad's occupation? They wrote accountant, then boom, they're a great candidate for club treasurer. Make sure that there's a link between what they want to do and what you need as well. And then what's the cost and when is it going to happen? So to find out the cost, make sure that you are accurate. You know, there are some builders that right now are giving quotes. You know how this quote will be valid for 30 days, this quote will be valid for 90 days. There are some builders that are right now saying this quote will be valid for 24 hours. The rise and fall in the construction industry at the moment is incredibly painful. It means that we just don't know. If you do have your costings and you're pretty sure that they're right, then there's a gap of 6 months, 9 months before you get the grant, and then you go to build it and costs have escalated. Do you think the funders are going to give you any more money? So who has to have that money? You do. All about the business viability of you as an organisation. You've got to make sure that you've got enough to cover escalation and to cover contingencies if things go wrong, if it rains, if it floods. You've got to make sure that you can cover those things. The time frame is really important as well. So if we are thinking about getting a grant for this, as the Tiddlywinks Club is, the grant that they're thinking of going for might not even open until June, July, August, which means they might not get it in until September, which means it probably won't be announced until Christmas. And then it's rainy, and so we can't start building until March next year anyway. Oh, and then we've got in April, we've got our national Tiddlywink titles, so we can't be a construction zone by then. So we can't already, we're more than 12 months down the track. And that's realistic if we're ready to go right now. If we're not ready to go because we can't answer yes to yes, we've got enough money to make sure we can maintain it, yes, we've got enough money to make sure that we can fund any overruns, then it might be 2 years. It might be 3 years. Every single facility development that I've been involved with that has taken, say, 4 years or longer, at the time felt painful. But in every single one of those cases, by the time it's built and constructed, everyone is really happy. And the fact that it took maybe a bit longer than we thought, they don't really mind because they're more happy to have the right thing built in the right place, the right way that meets their needs, rather than have rushed it and got it earlier. So yes, understand that because we're not just going to the bank and getting a loan or just doing it ourselves, there are factors that are going to make it take longer. That's okay. On that, I'm now going to hand over to Jamie and Bethan, who are going to walk you through some more complicating factors about this story.
Thanks. Hello, everybody. My name's Jamie, and I work in our site planning team at Council. So we look after sports and infrastructure planning. And I'll hand over to Bethan in a sec to introduce herself, but I've been asked by the Sport and Rec guys today to come and have a chat to you about some things that I've learned over the years, working actually with a number of some familiar faces here, Wendy and Alison, working with community organisations to navigate approvals. In previous roles, that was my job here at Council. So I'd like to share some learnings with you about that. I'll just hand over to Bethan and introduce herself quickly.
Thanks, Jamie. So I'm Bethan. I'm in the Building and Facilities Planning team, and we look at master planning sites, planning long term for our assets. Then we're involved in the feasibility and putting the development together for actual new buildings and renewals of our existing assets as well.
So I think so. Between us, we've learned a few things that I think would be beneficial. I guess the first thing is most of you be aware of Council's Improvement Works application process. This is a process that's been established for if you have a council lease, that is, on land that is council owned or controlled, then it's a way that we as council officers or technical specialists can assess a proposal and give authorization for that to happen. Now, that's incredibly important to have that process undertaken before you apply for grants. Often with the grants, you need landowners' consent, and that is how you obtain that. But the important part of that is that you have access to technical experts reviewing your proposal to make sure that we can, you know, it can happen. So I'm just going to refer to the slides here quickly, and we just kept it really high level. I'm not a building certifier at all. I'm a town planner, but I wanted to share at the very high level, and when tie into Michael's presentation before, the things that you probably need to think about in those questions is the process generally, as a rule of thumb, how it works. Sorry for our men shed folk out here. I've got a picture of a men shed because I wanted to find a picture of Tiddlywinks using a shed, but Tiddlywinks don't exist. So we have a men's shed over here, and we also have a building under some water. Typically, the first thing we want to be able to do is identify the use of the building or the use of the land. And this ties into the planning scheme and some other legislation. How are we going to use a building will determine what it's approved for and then how you can actually use it as an organisation going forward. Often, what we find is groups will build to the grant, to the funding that might be available. And that compromises actually how they intended to use that facility going forward. A use is defined under a council's planning scheme. There's also use requirements under building codes as well. And an example here with Tiddlywinks is they want to use the shed for storage. Great, that's fine. That building will be approved for storage. If they want to use it for office or something else, then we need to have a different discussion. And there's some reasons here, which I'll go through in a second. And again, at a very high level, that there are these different layers of approval, I suppose. So use. If Tiddlywinks are using their shed for storage, then it's probably going to be classed as a storage shed. If they are going to be using it for occupation, are they going to be inside of that building doing something? Or are they going to just have things stored in there that they go in quickly, grab it and come out? There's a difference there in how those buildings are used. Site planning. Where are you going to be putting that building? Can it be built there? What's the imaginary or the invisible lines that are, I guess, we all have, there is access to in the planning scheme and other things that actually help us to determine where things should be built. And that's part of my role now. Planning for this facility, for example. Where do we put things that are the most vulnerable assets to protect them from floods? This site flooded down the bottom. We knew it would. That's the site is designed to cater for that. So site planning. Is it best to be building an office or $1 million extension to our building in an area that is mapped or known or likely to be flooded? In the planning scheme, there are different levels of flooding and different chances, I suppose, of that flood occurring. So the events that we've had recently, some of them in some areas have been a 1% chance. That is a 1% chance every year that that flood will reach a certain level. It's also referred to sometimes as a 1 in 100. Now, this is in certain areas, not everywhere across the region. We didn't experience that across the whole of Moreton Bay. So there's a 1% chance that each year flooding will get to that level, perhaps on someone's site. And as Michael said before, often sport and recreation, open space assets are the fringe kind of land. So site planning, making sure that we're putting the building, understanding the use, what it's going to be used for, understanding where we can actually put it. Are we allowed to put it here? Probably not. This all then informs whether or not you need a planning approval. A planning approval we've largely just referred to here as that. Some people call it development approval or development assessment, and that is through Council's Development Services Department. That's if, and not always, that's if an application is triggered, and it's usually because of one of those two or combination of those. We've used flooding here, and I apologise if that's a bit too fresh for some people, but there's bushfire hazards. There's other hazards as well that are mapped. And if you're putting a building inside of one of these areas, it's probably going to trigger an application to Council's Development Services. So use and site planning may result in the need for a town planning approval. Once this is approved, you will then likely need a building approval. And this is undertaken in Moreton Bay and other local governments in Southeast Queensland by a private building certifier. We do not have certifiers on staff anymore. It used to be the way. Private building certifiers assess whether or not that building, what it's proposed to be used for, whether it's sited correctly, and whether or not it's going to be constructed to standards based on how those two elements at the top come together. Example, a storage shed that is not being used as a habitable space does not need to have the same construction standards as this $13 million building you're sitting in right now. And the reason is because we have to look at personal access and safety, fire hazards and fire safety, ingress and egress, accessibility, all sorts of things. This building here is being certified to a standard, which is much higher than a storage shed, if that makes sense. So we're just, the takeaway message is, how will it be used and can it be built there? I've done these arrows because, and you know, discussions with Alison and Wendy about their jobs previously, is that often getting advice from these people, or these people early on, will help you get this project through. So if you are proposing an infrastructure development that is of substantial cost, maybe it's you're going for a grant, you don't have the money. It is worth paying for private certifier advice or town planning advice, all both, early on. And this is what we do every day in our role, and that's exactly what we would do. Making sure that all of these line up will make sure that your project will go through as easy as it can go. This image over here is from the BCA. Now, there's actually new legislation in place, so I've got a cheeky disclaimer down here, and that is, please go and see a private building certifier about your project, because legislation about building codes changes all the time, okay? But I thought this was a great example of the types of buildings that we deal with, or community groups particularly might be dealing with. In the Tiddlywinks example, we have a place of assembly or a hall. It has a classification under the old BCA of 9B. We also have non-habitable buildings, which is sheds or private garages, have a different classification. And again, I'm not the expert in this field, but I can tell you that based on our experience, the requirements for these two codes as such changes quite significantly. So I guess we just wanted to ask a few questions and then and just some takeaway messages. Places people meet, spaces people occupy, have different requirements to a storage shed. Are you going to be meeting there? Is Tiddlywinks actually going to be using the shed as an office? What's the implications of that? Is it a habitable space? Habitable being, are you in it right now? This is a habitable space. There's people in here right now in this space. A storage shed, again, in and out. It's a difference. Clubhouses, meeting spaces, and sometimes we've had working with a lot of men sheds actually, what are they actually defined as? What building classification do they need to meet? Because you would think it's just a shed. It's just color bond shed. And a lot of the men shed movement is about working in the shed. It's not actually, it's used differently. And so you need to talk to a building certifier about what that building will be approved for, because we've had some men sheds that have had to have fire hydrants installed, water and sewer connected, emergency shower bays, things like that, which were not in the plan at the beginning. Talked about water, sewer, equitable access is a major one. To a storage shed, you probably do not need to have a 150 mil thick by 1.2 meter wide concrete footpath up to it. But to a habitable space, most definitely you probably will. This building here has been certified to be have equitable access. Tiddlywinks Community Hall probably does. Their shed probably not. Again, how are they going to be using that shed? Rule of thumb, storage shed stores items. It's not habitable. You're in and out. There are some provisions in either the planning scheme or in other legislation that might allow you to build a storage shed here. And because the risk to personal life or to life and the risk to the asset is probably, there's a less risk, I should say, for things, items stored in an area that might be subject to flooding or bushfire or whatever it might be, as opposed to a building that has houses people. And so That's really important as well. I just wanted to talk about the headings here. Again, I mentioned in my experience working with a number of community groups, these are actually things that people have said to me. First one, she'll be right, it's just a shed. I think we've covered that, not necessarily all the time. She'll be right, it's just a desk and chair. No one will know, it's okay. Well, you talk to your certifier about that and they might have a different opinion. So the takeaway message, I suppose, is get your planning and your certification professionals on board as soon as you can. There are grants available for that. If you're doing facility planning, then a small cost towards a professional opinion on your project will go a long way. And also, when you go to apply for your grants, it's one more tick that will get you your project probably ahead of someone else's. I might hand over to Bethan to see if there's something she wants to add to this from a technical perspective, but we came up with slides together, I'm sorry, but I think in the Tiddlywinks example, is there anything else, Bethan, that you think we should be talking about today?
Thank you. Just going back to the slide on cost. Sometimes you can get a builder to provide a bit of an idea of what it is that you're looking for. They're going to provide a cost. And then you'll come to council and say, we want an IWA, we want to build this facility, we're going to apply for a grant. And then we'll come back with a list of things. It could be that you're on landfill. It could be that we've got lots of other measures that are needed. It could be that we have to set it back from the boundary because of the planning policy in that area. And then all of a sudden, the cost that we think is certain kind of escalates, and there can be other remediation measures that haven't been considered. And then that's why that IWA process is so important, so that we can say, hey, have we considered this? Have we looked at that? So I guess just with costs, even if you do have a cost, then use us and talk to us and say, hey, does this sound valid? Does this look right to you? So I think I'd just kind of add that, especially if you're putting it forward for a grant application and you're relying on that money to be able to fund the project in its entirety. So I think that's all I'd like to add, really.
We might head over back over to Michael now to continue with the
form. Yep. Perfect. Thank you very much, Jamie and Bethan. Please give them a round of applause. Very helpful stuff. Before we do, does anyone have any questions or specific things that they'd like to pose to Jamie and Bethan? Yes. Planning consultant? Sometimes it is. So it depends on the grant. Sorry, for the people at home, the question was, sometimes there's a grant available for planning, for engaging consultants to help with the planning. Sometimes there is. Anything else to add?
It is a great question. And these guys over here might be best to help with that after we have finished the presentation. But previously, I'm sure when I was working with you guys, for example, there was a grant that you could apply for facility planning. And it was up to 10 grand or whatever it might be. And that was to help engage those technical specialists. You may be lucky and you may have a certifier on the committee.
Who's happy to do the work?
To do the work, maybe pro bono, but majority of the time is these are professionals. They've got their insurance they need to cover. They're probably going to charge a fee, and it's probably best to chat with them first, and then see what grants are available.
Great, thank you. Okay, so I'm going to wrap up by looking at what it takes to get these things operating now. So this will be a very quick flyby in the interest of time, but it doesn't mean it's not important. This is really, really important. There are some projects that have got to almost there, and then the organisations have thought, we just can't sustain it. We won't put our organisation at risk for the sake of funding something that we then can't maintain or that we can't replace. If you build it, will you be able to run it? Can you afford to run it? This is, again, looking inwardly. So we started with looking at why we exist and making sure that we've got what we're trying to achieve right before we build anything. At the other end, we're now saying, well, do we have the sort of business model that is going to give us enough money to make sure that we can do the required maintenance and repairs when they need to be done and meet our obligations for replacement as per the lease conditions. Can you manage it? This is purely practical. Again, although we may have some event planners and facility managers in our organisation, do they have the availability to do that? Or is that something that to do that effectively, we would need to outsource? So notice that this $13 million facility isn't purely volunteer run. Sure, there are plenty of volunteers who are active here, but it's not a purely volunteer activated space. And finally, can you afford to replace it when it reaches the end of its useful life? And as I said, that look in your lease conditions, because you will have an obligation, council will have likely have an obligation. So it's about, again, understanding that obligation before you launch into it. Don't skimp. Yes, there may be grants available for some of this stuff, but if there isn't, still do it. Yes, there will be costs involved in doing the planning. Yes, there will be costs involved in seeking the building certifier advice early and seeking the planning advice early. Just because those costs exist and just because a grant may not be available or you may not be eligible to get a grant to cover those costs doesn't mean you shouldn't do it. Because it's when you skip those steps, when you skimp on what you should be investing, that the little problems now, the she'll be right problems, end up getting blown into very, very big problems. There are a range of things that I would like to leave with you today, and these are all designed to make this easy for you to follow. I'll show you the list first. So these are the things that I've got for you. Here is the worksheet, a downloadable resource that is a high quality PDF, so you can zoom right in on each of the steps and see everything. And the first person can come and have my printouts. I won't need them again. Next is the planning guide. The actual workbook here that we've already been through. Then it comes down to facility management. So I've got here a full life cycle asset register. That's a Word document. You can have that for free. So it says, what is the asset? When did we build it? How much did it cost? Who built it? If it's something that we've bought, like a phone or a PowerPoint clicker, what's the model number, the serial number? What's its warranty? All of that information can go in here. When do we need to replace it? How much is it going to cost us to replace it? So you can have access to that as a full life cycle asset register, but I implore you, please don't use it. You can have it for free, but don't use it. Now that's because it's not going to tell you anything. Instead of using that, we developed Asset Track to track assets, to give you total reporting and control over your assets. So instead of it being a Word document, an Excel spreadsheet that no matter how hard I try, it can look really, really pretty, but it's not going to prompt you when maintenance is due. It's not going to prompt you when an asset reaches the end of its useful life. It's not going to prompt you if one of your volunteers who's gone and looked at the shed has said, oh, this shed is no longer fit for purpose. We need to replace it. The Excel spreadsheet won't notify you. Asset Track will. So that's why when I was teaching about this stuff in 2013, 14, 15, I just wanted to be able to say, just go and pay for this app. It's cheap. Just go and use it. And nothing existed. So that's why I very naively thought, well, let's go and develop it ourselves. So we have. So it starts with the asset register. But what sits behind that are all of the prompts. So you set up all, and you can put your buildings in there, absolutely. But you can also put, you know, when the phone goes missing or the secretary who we've given a club computer and then they take it at the end of their term and you lose it. So it keeps track of everything. It keeps track of keys. Who has a key? Do you have key registers? You can keep it all in here and you can be prompted to know who needs to do what and when. So it's built around the asset register, but then you drill into all of the asset details with photos and prompts and emails that go to you when they need to, emails that go to the inspector. So it also filters out all of the work in asset management, so it's not just one person. If you have a quartermaster, an asset coordinator, a facility coordinator, it shouldn't be that one person's job to do all of the maintenance. So this enables you to be able to filter it out. You can, if you've got professionals that need to come in and do your test and tag, your gas inspection, your plumbing inspection, cleaning the ventilation above the extraction hoods above the deep fryer, if you need to have that done on a certain frequency, you can even program that to go straight to your contractors. There is a cost to Asset Track. This is free. The cost is about $200 a year. I'm happy to give you a discount on that if you want to get you in to use it, but this won't save you any time. This will be a pain in the proverbial using systems that exist. And yes, unashamedly, this is one that we've developed, but we developed it especially for you. That's why it's cheap. That's why it also gives you exactly the information. So when you program it in, what maintenance do we need to do on a new building? Well, just select the type of building that it is, select the type of maintenance you want, and boom, it populates the activity, the things that you need to do. Gives you an idea of the frequency of when you need to do those. So there's also the final piece of the puzzle is a little demo video. There's a really good looking bloke talking you through how to get information in there, how to use it. If you want more information, then there's a little help button and everything's there as well. Plus you all know me, so you can come and ask me any questions. On that, I would like to say it has been an absolute pleasure to deliver some of this information to you this morning. We will all be hanging around through morning tea and then afterwards as well. So if there's any questions that you want to go through specifically about how what you are doing mirrors the tiddlywinks, then please come and see us. So before I wrap up and hand over to, I think, a break next, do you have any questions from the online audience so far? Awesome. Any questions from the floor? Notice what I did then? I said that before we have a break, so you're going, oh, copy. We do have a question, yes. The question is, so what sort of organisation size is AssetTrack built for? It's across the board. So there comes a size, so for the Tiddlywinks Club with 150 members and quite a bit of stuff, like even their things like board games, I've got a board game club that is using it because they need to keep track of who has their board games because they go to different people. So there are different reasons that you would use it for organisations of different sizes, but for 150 with a lease, with obligations for maintenance in that lease, then the Tiddlywinks Club would be a good example. So there are organisations with fewer assets that are easy enough. If you get in on a Word document or an Excel spreadsheet, if you're getting below about there on the page, then it's probably enough to start to say the prompts, don't look at the cost, don't look at the fees for subscribing to software as a cost, look at it as an investment. Is the return on that investment significant enough? Not necessarily in, I pay $200, I'm gonna get 2000 back, but I pay $200, I'm gonna save 200 hours over the year. I'm gonna pay $200, we're not gonna lose one phone, one computer that costs $1,000, $2,000. So that's the return on the investment that you get. So yes, if it's beyond about there, then it's worthwhile considering what it's buying us back is that time and sometimes sanity. Anything else? Excellent. Thank you very much.
All right. Thank you, Michael. Thank you, Jamie. Thank you, Bethan.